You is Armin Rigo. He's going to be talking about Pai Pai. Armin has a list of qualifications that is way too long to talk about. Many degrees, very smart guy. I look forward to hearing him. Armin, thank you very much. Cheers.
Thank you. Can we switch the screen, please? Okay, so I'm here to talk about PyPy. Well, what is PyPy to start with? PyPy is an alternative Python interpreter. It comes including a just-in-time compiler, which is basically all I want to say here. I mean, here is an example. That's some completely stupid Python code, a one-page example. This is, well, you have the main loop here where you add the number I and then you add the invert of the number I, but well, you notice that everything is done with instance of this class number instead of real integers. So running this on top of CPython has a huge overhead. You need to create and throw away the instance of the class, etc., etc. This is just a small example, right? So, if I run it, well, first, okay, I can run PyPy. It's exactly like CPython, basically, with one essential difference, is that the prompt that you see here has 4 instead of 3. Greater than signs. Well, okay, it's a Python interpreter, right? So I can do stuff. Print hello if one, print hello, and then correct my mistake on the previous line. Okay. Now, if I try to run the example I showed before, foo, let's run it 1 billion times. Takes a while. Done. Okay, so what occurred? This horrible loop actually ran 1 billion times on my machines, which runs about 2 billion CPU instructions per second, and it took about 3 seconds. So what? It means that this code, this loop, is actually done in about 6 CPU instructions, which is, well, great, I suppose. I mean, you really need to allocate 2 numbers. So add plus equal allocates 1 extra number, this allocates 1 extra number, this allocates 1 extra number. It's all reduced to 6 CPU cycles. Okay, this is the most extreme kind of example on which PyPy is great, well, at least greatly faster than CPython. Now, of course, PyPy is actually a Python interpreter that is able to run big programs, and, well, the speedups are not completely incredibly good, like this particular example, but still. How fast is PyPy? This is a web page updated nightly, containing some number of benchmarks. I mean, it's probably too small to read. It's some number of real life benchmarks, and you can see here, well, that's the speed of CPython 2.7.2, and that's the speed in PyPy. So it's generally faster. Depends a bit on the benchmark, but you can see here how has PyPy performance evolved over time. This is PyPy 1.4. Well, this is CPython. This is PyPy 1.4, which was in 2010, and this is now. So it's, I mean, the geometric average on our particular set of benchmarks is 5.68 times faster. Okay, and the kind of benchmarks is, well, this does not include the stupid benchmark I showed just before. It's really more, you have a Django which builds a complete table, I mean a large and wide table in the Django preprocessing system, and well, twisted here, Spitfire, Spambase, real life, basically, examples you have here. Okay. So this is what PyPI is a bit more precisely. A bit of history, PyPI was actually around since 2003. So, well, it was not production ready since 2 years ago. The release was 1.4, which means it was a lot of work to do, but we are basically getting there now. It actually had a lot of funding. The European Union had it in its framework program 6, gave us money. Then the Eurostars program, which is another European program, and nowadays we are running on donations from individuals. Yes, the current status, the numbers that I showed already. Well, also, there are more PyPI friendly programs than before now, in the sense that, well, the incredible speed I just showed in my stupid example, well, it was already that good 2 years ago. However, in these 2 years, we improved a lot on the overall speed of a Python program actually doing things with tons of modules and things. So now we are in the process, I should say, but we already have gone some way towards avoiding situation where your program is 17 times faster here, but twice as slow there, and with a negative mean in the end. Okay, we have some, well, PyPI is being recognized in the sense that you can find it in most common Linux distributions. There is a Windows 32-bit version and a Mac version. And also another point is that it is also PyPI is very different interpreter than CPython. It is able to run the C extension modules that are written using the CPython C API. So it's able to run them at least in some kind of slow and emulated mode, but it's able to run them. And so we run big parts at least of PyOpenSSL and LXML, and probably a large number of other C extension modules. Well, the current organization of PyPI is part of the Software Freedom Conservancy, which is a US non-profit organization. Bradley, who is Software Freedom Conservancy chairman, successfully fights US bureaucracy, so we're happy about it. The current funding model is that people or companies can give us small or large amounts of money, so it's a bit like a Kickstarter style kind of money. And we have three sub-projects running now. The Py3K, whose goal is to port PyPI to Python 3. The NumPy sub-project, whose goal is to make a fast implementation of NumPy in PyPI. And the STM sub-project, Software Transactional Memory, well, which I will talk a bit more later during this talk. So yes, we got some number like $100,000 in total, which is great, I suppose. Mm-hmm. Well, a quick word about PyPy's just-in-time compiler. Well, it removes abstractions, like we have seen with number classes in my stupid example at the start of the talk. It actually removes the abstraction. Of course, there is no way that in 6 CPU cycles you can actually allocate 5 of these instances and then free them. The just-in-time compiler is actually figuring out that they are created there and destroyed, well, forgotten there, so that it can actually remove the overhead of actually creating it at all. So this is a strong point of our JIT compiler. And another point is that our JIT compiler almost never gives up. I mean, if you want a comparison, for example, TraceMonkey, which used to be a similar kind of JIT compiler for Firefox by Mozilla, well, they kind of gave up on the idea, or at least partly gave up, because, well, we think that their problem was that their JIT compiler was great as long as you hit paths for which they have the JIT compiler. As soon as you try to do something using JavaScript for which a JIT compiler does not specifically have a path, then it has to fall back to the interpreter. And then, well, it's costly basically to switch between the JIT compiler and the interpreter. So one difference is that in our case, our JIT compiler, the difference is that it is automatically generated, which means, well, PyPy is written, one detailed quote about how PyPy is written is that PyPy is written completely in Python, and then this Python code, which is actually some Python dialect that we call RPython, but that we can still run as normal Python, well, this RPython code is translated to C code. So we translate statically the interpreter. This is the interpreter. So in particular, our JIT compiler works by analyzing the interpreter itself. So we have a JIT compiler that works with any other language, like I said here, in the sense that if you come up with an implementation of an interpreter and write it in RPython, then you can use our toolchain, the toolchain in PyPy, to get out of it the translation of the interpreter in C code and a just-in-time compiler for your particular language. So this has, well, this has both an overhead in terms of, well, of runtime, like for example the warm-up time of our just-in-time compiler is huge. I mean, it's really completely incredible if you compare it with other just-in-time compilers that exist nowadays. I mean, for the largest programs, we actually, well, I mean, we have a program that runs for half an hour, for example. On this program, it's a huge and big program. In this program, there is about 1 minute of just making code that will be run by the JIT. But it still ends up being about 2.5 times faster than CPython. So this was a very quick overview of our JIT. Yes, it works on x86, 32/64 bit, on ARM V7, and soon on Power 64 machines. Mm-hmm. So yes. So as I'm trying to explain, we are really we are really now focusing on real world applications instead of small tiny examples, and we are getting somewhere basically. Real world applications run and they run faster on PyPy, generally speaking. So try it basically. It would be my recommendation. Quickly digging into what we are currently working on. There is a Py3K proposal whose goal is to support Python 3. So the goal will be to have a version of PyPy which itself is a Python 3 interpreter. Well, we will support Python 3 but also continue to support Python 2, because simply PyPy itself is written in Python 2, and we are self-hosting basically, and we want to continue to be self-hosting. So yes, this is the current status of the Python 3 branch. Focus on correctness rather than speed right now. First 90% done, remaining 90% not done. And it turns out that a lot of people have contributed. However, for this sub-project, the majority of the funds have been provided by Google, who I should thank. The second sub-project is NumPy, so the Python library with, handling matrices, basically. Extremely used, fundamental in the scientific usage of Python. Progress is going on slowly. This is, multidimensional arrays, broadcasting, fancy indexing, this is all done. All D types except string objects. I think complexes are done by now. We are getting generally good results for performance, which means at least as fast as C Python, which is already something. But actually, there are use cases where we manage to be faster. Even for you have to realize that NumPy is really only about huge matrices, and most of the time actually spent in a typical NumPy program is Fortran or C code that will work over the matrix to do something like addition or multiplication. And we still manage to be faster, basically, using various tricks. I will not go into the details now. And the last subtopic is software transactional memory. I will explain it a bit later. The goal is to remove the global interpreter lock. I mean, who knows what the global interpreter lock is in Python? So this is one. How should I say? I should say it's one path towards a global interpreter lockless version of Python, and it actually works because I have a working prototype. But also, the important point is that it actually opens the door to new models. I mean, you will be able to use to not actually have to use threads to run a process on multiple cores, which just sounds strange, right? Okay, and the last thing I want to talk about is calling C. How do you call C code from Python code in general? Well, there is no single answer. You can write a C-Python C extension, but you can also use wrapper generators like Swig. Or you can use something a bit strange like C-types, in which you write pure Python code in which you describe what C code you want to call. Or there is also Syphon, which is kind of great. Well, we decided that none of these was convenient, so we made another one, which we call CFFI, because, well, foreign function interface for C. Here is an example. I mean, the strange bit, which comes from LuaJIT, actually, it's a great idea. Well, I think it's a great idea, but it took me a while to understand why it's a great idea, is that you call cffi.cdef. This is all Python code, right? Except this thing. It's a big string that contains C function declarations. So just by having this, it's enough for the printf call here to work, in the sense to really be able to call this C function. Yes, it just looks crazy, but it's actually very convenient. And this line here is the very same thing than the C line, where you would declare a variable of type char bracket, give it the name arg, and initialize it with the string world. It's very much the same line, because in C, in this case, you can also omit the length. Mm-hmm. Well, so the general idea is that in CFFI, well, you want to call C code. Well, then you have to write C. Okay, it's kind of obvious. I mean, compare it with C-types, for example. If you know C-types, you can do mostly the same thing, except that it's much bigger, because every time, well, you cannot declare this function printf as one line. You have to declare it as Python code. Declare there is function printf, oh, it will take an argument that is of type C-types.c underscore char underscore p, I think. And the dot dot dot, I don't even remember how you do it in C types and so on and so forth. Well, here the point is that really you write in your code cf5cdef, triple quote, then you paste things from the man page, and then you close the triple quote and it works. Well, okay, this was a kind of side topic. I mean, in the sense that this CFFI module is actually available on both CPython and PyPy, and well, performance-wise, maybe a side note, performance-wise, on top of CPython, it's a bit slowish. I mean, it's on the same kind of performance than C-types. However, on PyPy, if you have here a call, and I don't know, put it in a loop and something, so that it has time, so the JetSynam compiler has enough time to warm up, then you end up with the generated code, the generated assembler produced by our JIT will directly contain the call to the actual C function. Well, you can't possibly be any faster, basically. And yes, well, here's the kind of thing you can do. Well, basically we're pushing it forward because we found out that it's a great way to do calling C functions in context of PyPy. It also works fine on CPython, but in the context of PyPy, the problem is that all the other points, all the other ways, C extension and C siphon and so on, they all have a lot of issues. They are too much, too deeply interconnected with C Python. Mm-hmm. Okay, and here I have a nice slide about software transactional memory. So So now I want to give you an overview about, well, something you should know, how the global interpreter loop works. If you define a function here is a function that will pop an item from one list and append it into another list. Okay? Now you imagine that this code is actually run as part of a bigger program that is a multi-threaded program. And the list one and list two are also visible from other threads. And maybe other threads will also modify the same list. Okay? So here, what we want and what this code really does is it removes the last item from list one and put it into list two. Okay? Sounds obvious. So in particular, if, for example, you have another place running in another thread that returns the sum of the length of the two lists, it should be intuitively obvious that this should, well, like if you have 10 items here and 0 here, this should return 10. But it will not actually always return 10, of course, as you know, because here it can run up to here and get the answer 10 from this, and then it runs this. So then it finishes running that, and it sees the x here. So this will be 1, so it will return 11. But that, of course, at no point in time are there 11 elements in total in my two lists. So this is of course completely obvious basically to anyone that needs to deal with multiple threads. And of course the issues are actually the same, or it is already simpler in Python than it would be in Java or in C. Because if you're trying to do the same thing in Java or in C, you're likely to get completely sec faults or random memory corruption and, well, crash basically. So why don't you get crashes in Python? Well, because the language design pushed forward by Guido is to say you should not get crashes in Python. So how did they fix it? They added a global interpreter lock, which means that in practice only one thread can advance the computation. So basically, for example, this list.pop will be run atomically. We know that this will both return x and remove it from the list, and it will do it all atomically, in the sense that it's not actually possible that this code would get a strong result because this has already half run, for example. Okay? Well, what if you actually had a way to write in Python with atomic? And this would be just asking, oh, and please, I want to run these two lines, but I don't want anybody else to actually run in parallel. So, I mean, this is actually very easy to implement in C-Python, for example. This just means run the content of the WIF block without releasing the global interpreter lock. You keep it. Okay? Well, here you would need to write it here too. And now your program really behaves as you would expect. Now, this atomic thing can be implemented in C-Python. And, well, why hasn't it been done already? Because so far, I mean, like in the last decade or so, it was thought to be the wrong approach, the wrong point of view. There is no way, for example, you can implement it on JSON, on R, on Python, on this other Python implementation, because they themselves, well, themselves they use their own native virtual machines abstractions for threads, and these abstractions don't include things like Atomic, so you cannot implement it. So this was pushed forward as one of the reasons, but well, what I'm trying to push forward now is that it's actually a very bad idea, and this Atomic is the future, basically, quote. Because, okay, now you have written your program like this, and it's safe, okay? But then, let's say I want to do some, well, I have a big dict containing stuff, and for every key of the dictionary, I want to compute something. Then, well, for key in the dictionary, compute the thing, okay? Now, if I tried to run the various computations in different threads, I would not gain anything, right? Because of the global interpreter log. But let's ignore that. Let's unreally spawn different threads. So you can actually imagine some kind of API that is a bit hiding the fact that it's using raw threads, like you can say, here I want to do things with my key, so this just register all the thing you want to do, and then transaction run, which will actually pop the items from this list one after the other and run them in a thread pool, for example. You can imagine this kind of thing, okay? Of course, here we are actually writing Python. So, well, the issue is if there are conflicts between the various things you need to do. Like for handling key one, a particular key, and key two, you have to update this global cache, for example. So then you need to start being very careful about the update to the global cache. I don't know, maybe add locks carefully, a bit everywhere, etc. Well, okay. Or there is the alternative: what if transaction.run is actually implemented by saying with Atomic do the step, then you get the completely strange because useless model that you would be running several threads, but actually only one of them can proceed the next item, and all the other ones are waiting. Okay, so what did we gain? Well, what we gained is that actually there is a way to implement this Atomic differently, more efficiently. There is a way to have with Atomic allow two different Atomic blocks in two different threads to run in parallel. But then it's called transactional memory, and well, it's basically involved, but only in terms of the implementation. In terms of the implementation, it's involved because what do you need to do? You need to start both threads in parallel, but carefully detect when one, for example, would actually create a situation that conflicts with the other one. So you need to detect this kind of conflicts automatically, and when they occur, well, you need to pause one of the two threads or even roll back, which means cancel what it has done, and then retry again. Well, this is called transactional memory, because it's very similar to the concept of transaction found in databases, where well, you start your transaction, you try to do things. Well, while you are running your transaction, you see a consistent view of the database, meaning you don't see the other updates occurring in parallel. And then at the end, you try to commit, and either it works, or you have conflict somewhere, and then it fails, and then you typically loop over and try again the operation you just did. So the trying again in the case of PyPy here is hidden under the carpet, but apart from that, it's mostly the same idea. So what do you get? You get a model in which you can actually run multiple threads that each have big transactions, like with atomic and maybe not one line of code, but things that actually do things. I mean, you can really imagine that instead of this simple line, you have things that really take 0.1 second to run or something like that. But you can run, you can really have a model in which you have multiple threads, and all these atomic blocks will appear to you as a programmer as if they were ordered in some way. I mean, like a normal transaction in a database, right? They appear to be ordered, but they have actually run in parallel on multiple cores or on multiple machines, if we're talking about database. So this is basically the model that I'm working now right now on PyPy, and well, it works already. Bigger. Yes, this is a version of PyPy which does not have a JIT included. However, it has some atomic built in, and in this version of PyPy you can really run examples. I mean, I have an example running one of our own benchmarks, and you can really run it on multiple threads, and it speeds up things basically. Well, yes. Right now, it's a bit of the kind you have to believe me, because yes, it speeds up things, but then it has a constant 2 or 3 times slower overhead, which means that on this machine, which has really only 2 different cores, then well, you don't see any speed up, of course. However, well, I mean, the real goal of the project is. It's not, I mean, if your company is called Google and you have an issue like 10,000 servers running your program and you have a performance issue there, then you have a performance issue, and then you need to have clever people looking into the program how to optimize it. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about here. What I'm talking about here is a situation where you write a program. And well, it can be a throwaway program, whatever, a small server, anything, and you have a performance problem in the sense that, well, it's really getting too slow running it on one CPU of this server, but it's stupid because I know that this server has 24 cores or something like that. Well, then this is basically the kind of target I'm talking about. this is the kind of target that can really get sped up by these techniques. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you, Armin. I'm sure there's going to be lots of questions. I can see one already. Let me get you the mic because we are recording it, so your question will be on the recording.
Hi. I was just wondering with your STM, does it use a similar model to a similar pattern to what you were showing with the width atomic, or does it try to figure out what block should be atomic by itself?
No. It is using the same model.
The same
model? I mean the
So you mark atomic blocks?
Yes.
Okay.
How it works is that you have two kinds of atomic blocks.
Yeah.
You have the implicit blocks that are basically running from one point where you would release the gel until the next point where you would release the gel. And here, instead of a gel, you mark everything in between as one transaction.
Okay, cool.
And then you have the with atomic block, which allows you to get larger transactions.
Thank you.
More questions?
You say there's an interaction with other languages just at the bottom of one of the slides. Is R Python generic enough to be able to implement other languages with it besides Python?
Yes. R Python is a very generic language. Well, it's really targeted towards implementing other languages, but it has been used for at least demo versions of JavaScript, Prolog. There is some scheme interpreter, and then nowadays we are working on PHP and Ruby.
Sure. Okay.
Well, some of us are.
Good luck with that.
Yes, exactly.
How does this tie into LLVM?
Yes, well, LLVM, LLVM is a great project that we tried to use about 4 or 5 times. I mean, how does it tie to it? Well, one thing is that LLVM is really at the level of the C compiler, right? What you really need here is a language like RPython, which is at a higher level. I mean, RPython is still completely garbage collected, for example. We have an implementation of Python that really uses lists and dictionaries in the implementation. And we don't care about freeing memory, like all the pyincref and pydecref that you see in the source code of CPython. We don't have any of that. So it's really a higher level.
Can you implement RPython with LLVM?
Yes.
Because then you'd have a tool chain all the way down.
Yes. Our standard way to implement RPython is to generate C code and then throw it into GCC. However, we also have at least an experimental way to generate LLVM bytecode and send it through LLVM. But, well, that's a bit what the point. You can also generate C code and then compile it with Clang, with C-Lang. Yeah, and it works great.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, my question is, in the software transactional memory, is it a goal to kind of emulate, I want to say, the semantics of a global interpreter lock?
Yes. So the goal is to preserve semantics completely, which also has other advantages, like you have all your existing multi-threaded Python code, well, that will still run fine.
Hi. You mentioned that ARM is a supported platform. What
yes.
is the performance difference, perhaps, between ARM and x86 at the moment look like?
I don't know exactly. ARM is a supported platform in the sense that we have a JIT backend able to produce directly ARM instructions in memory. This JIT backend was done on it's actually relatively good, probably did not see as many of the tiny optimizations that we put in the x86 backend, but I think it's good, basically. It's not great, but good, I would say.
Hi. Yes. Awesome project. For a lot of us who know Python, are comfortable with Python, but not quite level at the like Python level that you guys are operating at, how can we get involved in PyPy, and what can we do? I fully understand that not everyone needs to be able to write a JIT in order to get involved in an open source project.
Yes.
What are sort of entrance level things that people can get involved in?
Well, yes, PyPy is also a large collection of very different things, and you can actually get involved in one corner of PyPy and not knowing at all anything about the rest. I mean, we have somebody that actually contributed very good optimizations of the just-in-time compiler, and he knows only the optimizer of the just-in-time compiler, right? He does not know anything about Python semantics, let's say. So, reversely, we have people that contribute on NumPy, for example. So the problem is to write an implementation of NumPy in RPython. Well, they are doing so and not caring about the JIT, but getting the JIT for free, basically, for them. And yes, there are just a lot of levels, like somebody really came and used RPython in order to implement its own completely experimental dynamic language, for example, and he was completely happy because well, the speed is good enough. I mean, we have a garbage collector that is good enough. We have a JIT, and you get all this for free.
Cool. Thank you very much, Armin. Unfortunately, we have to move on. But thank you again. Please give him a round of applause.